الأكرم والنبي الأكرم والنور المجسم والكنز المقلسم محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين رضي الله عن أصحابه الأكرمين وعنا معهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. يقول الله العظيم في كتابه الكريم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير، الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا وهو العزيز الغفور.
The first thing you start with is always that Quran carry on. Since I, mashallah, my fellow brother, Allah bless him, said all these things I don't deserve. And that's his good cause, because he's a good man. He thinks everyone is like him. But yes, it is indeed, alhamdulillah, my honor actually to come and be among people like yourselves and like him and like the ulama that we have here, mashallah. And alhamdulillah, it is, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put us in the majalis fi yawm fil jannah, sitting like this and talking and saying, subhanallah, alhamdulillah, we're sitting. Peterborough.
إنا كنا في أهلنا مشفقين.
The Quran talks about this majalis.
You don't think there's only majalis in dunya, there's majalis in akhira. And the mu'mineen will come and together. The Quran talks about them say, إنا
they talk to each other. Yani dialogue now. Look at this. Let's take a preview. Preview to Jannah. May Allah make us among the people of Jannah.
In Jannah, you see the mu'mineen sitting together and they say, إِنَّا كُنَّا فِي أَهْلِنَا مُشْفِقِينَ. When we were with our back like this in dunya, we were careful, we were talking about Allah, we were talking about the love of Allah, the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the love of the awliya, the love of the ulama, the love of this, And therefore, Allah saved us. See, not because of our deeds. Our deeds, where are they going to take us? But because Allah's care for us, Allah's rahmah for us, Allah's mercy for us, Allah's afu for us, Allah's maghfirah for us.
تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير. هذه سورة تبارك. سورة تبارك. Or سورة الملك. Has many names in the matter of fact.
حتى among the names, it's called المانعة or Surah Al-Munjiya. And I'll tell you in a little bit why it's called the Mani'a. Al-Mani'a means the barrier. Al-Munjiya means the savior or the protector.
This is among the names of Surah Al-Mulk.
الذي خلق الموت والحياة.
Allah tells us so.
He is the one who created death and life. ليبلوكم. So he tests you. أيكم أحسن عملا. Which one of you has better deeds?
Let's go to a different talk. We'll come back to the ayah. Keep the ayah in mind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created human beings, ordered them to have societies that are based on mercy and rights, justice. Have you heard of the Muslims? They are obligated by the deen to live in a just, respectful society. And again, I say, because Muslims care about every single human being. And unlike what some people may think, but Islam affirms the dignity and the
worth of every human being, regardless of who they are. I understand Islam came to give people life, not to take life away from people. To give people hope, not to take hope away from people. To provide people with keys to happiness, not to take the keys of happiness from people. And Islam came to make Muslims the servers of humanity.
To lead them to the pleasure of the Creator.
But in order for people to be happy, there has to be justice. If there is no justice, there is no happiness.
Ajeeb, subhanAllah.
Yeah, anytime there is zulm, there is injustice, there is no happiness.
إذا الإيمان ضاع
فلا أمان. Which means if there is no إيمان, there is no أمان. If there is no إيمان, because إيمان ensures what? إيمان ensures justice. If there is no justice, there is no safety. People are not safe, then you can't trust people. Because there is nothing that stops them. But that's why they say, the elderly, ask our grandfathers. Because sometimes, some people, and I say that to the new generation, because you know, people go through these things. They think just because their grandparents and grandparents did not go through Oxford University and Harvard University, that means they're not educated. They think they don't know. And what the problem with these people is they fail to distinguish between education and vocational training. Because the elderly are educated in the school of life, the university of life, which teaches you many more lessons than simply at a university that you go into and take 3 courses in. What did the elderly say, if you remember? They say this. I'll tell you from the Arabic culture, I'm sure you have a similar thing. They say, those who fear Allah, trust them. Those who don't fear Allah, fear them. He who doesn't fear Allah, fear him. Why? Because there's nothing that stops him. Therefore, there's need for justice. Because Muslims are also parts of any society. They are responsible members of any society. They are positive contributors to any society they live in. They are also elements to ensure justice in societies. When there is no justice, then there is no happiness. But as you all know, human beings are not perfect. And no matter how good human laws are, they are not perfect. That's why you see many criminals, they get away without being punished. We all know, not everyone who steals gets punished. Not everyone who murders gets punished and gets caught. Not everyone. There is no complete justice in this world. There's lots of zulm. But where is the justice? There's gonna be justice. Why do we believe there's gonna be justice? Because we believe the Creator, Jalla Jalaluhu, is attributed with justice. Al-Adl, among the names of Allah. And is attributed with wisdom, Al-Hakim.
Among the names of Allah is Al-Adl and Al-Hakim.
Because Allah is just and wise, attributed with wisdom, then it is impossible that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would let the transgressor of the zalim get away with the zulm in dunya and in the akhirah. There is no way. The zalim and the transgressor and the tyrant must come to accountability. If not in this dunya, therefore it must be in the akhirah. This is the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And because then there has to be a day of accountability for everyone, where the books are open, and nothing is hidden anymore, and there are no connections, and there are no lobbying, and there is no money that can pay off your ways, and there is no power that can pay off your ways, there has to be a day of judgment and a day of accountability where you stand and everything is known. And the judge is Allah. In order for that to happen, there has to be death. Now, this is the little introduction, it's okay? So we can enter the topic. There has to be death after death, then?
That's the introduction to the day of accountability. But we look at death as the most vivid fact we see every single day. People have time.
Death, when we look about death, and we know that death has separated people, separated the lovers, and separated families.
What kind of creation is death?
How many times death made people cry, people? And how many times death made children orphans, and wives widows, and tribes menless and womenless? How many times did death destroy civilizations?
Yet we look at this and we sort of close our eyes and we give it an eye shut from this whole thing, as if it doesn't exist, though we see it in front of us.
Somehow we feel that this is going to happen to everybody else but me. But if you take a look at the civilizations, where is Ad? Where is Qawm Ad wa Qawm Thamud? Where is Fir'aun? Where is Haman? Where is Qarnun? Where are all these kings and all these tyrants and all these Qubat and all these princes and all these people? Where are all these civilizations? What happened to them?
وجاءت سكرة الموت بالحق ذلك ما كنت منه تحيد.
I'm not kidding. This is what you are trying to stay away from.
You know that Abdin, when he was given his hukma to Sham in Damascus, he looked at the people and he saw the dunya in their eyes. He saw that there is somehow the dunya, the death is not even mentioned somehow. You can feel that in the eyes of people. And he said this very, very famous khutbah. Let me just take you through the lines, some of the scenes of the khutbah, because the Imam Zain al-Abidin was not only talking to them, he's talking to me and you. He stood on that manbar and said, أيها الناس اعلموا أن الدنيا دار زوال وانتقال. This dunya that you live in is a place that changes. If anything is consistent about life, it is change. تنتقل بأهلها من حال إلى حال. It takes its people from one situation to the other. يعني the rich becomes poor and the poor becomes rich. The weak becomes powerful and the powerful turns weak. The healthy becomes sick. Sometimes the sick becomes healthy. It's always changing. There's always change. It's never persistent. Whenever you think it's going to be consistent, that's when it cheats you and changes overnight. تنتقل بأهلها من حال إلى حال. قد أفلت القرون الماضية. Has destroyed the centuries before you. Centuries. Hundreds of years has destroyed them. والأمم الخالية. And the nations that live, civilizations that have lived on this earth. أكلتهم أيدي السماء. The hand of history ate them up. واحترق عليهم الأفاعي والديدان. And they were put in the grave as food for the ants and the snakes. أكلتهم الدنيا. الدنيا ate them up. Decelerated them. Degenerated them. Destroyed them. Eliminated them. فكأنهم ما كانوا لها أهلا ولا سكانا. As if they have never ever even put a step on this earth. As if they have never inhabited this earth. أَكْلَ تُرَابْ لِحُمْهُمْ. The sand and the soil ate their flesh. وَبَدَّدَ أَوْصَالَهُمْ. And it destroys their joints. وَغَيَّرَ شَمَائِلَهُمْ. And it changed their characteristics. وَأَزَالَ مَحَاسِنَهُمْ. And it altered their beauties.
You look in the mirror, you think you're really looking. That's what happened after that. And then he told them, أَخَطَطْ مَعُونَ بِالْبَطَارِ بَعْدَهُمْ.
He looked at the people and says, do you think you're going to be lasting, everlasting, going down? You're not going to die. Everything, everybody else died. You're not going to die. Hayat. Don't fool yourself. La budda lakum min an nuhuqim him. You will always follow their footsteps and die. What is the solution? فَتَدَارَكُوا مَا بَقِيَ مِنْ أَعْمَالِكُمْ بِصَالِحِ أَعْمَالِ. This life that you have left, today you are 20 years old. How many years you have left? One day maybe? One hour maybe? 30 years maybe? Nothing maybe? More? Less? Change this life that you have left into a good deed. Today, not tomorrow. Today. Now. Now make an intention of tawbah in your heart. Now make that intention that Allah might take any minute, any second you are there. Now, not tomorrow, not after 1 hour. How do you know you can live for an hour? And then he tells them, وَكَأَنِّي بِكُمْ وَقَدْ مَقِلْتُمْ مِنْ خُبُورِكُمْ مِنْ خُصُورِكُمْ إِلَىٰ خُبُورِكُمْ. He looked at them, he saw the dunya sitting on their hearts. He says, I'm looking at you as if you are now moving from your qusur, from your palaces and homes, into your qubur, into your graves. Very tough. Long journey. With that. Some other time we continue with the khutbah Nams and Harim because it's long. But long journey that starts only with death. After death, you have what? Alam al-Barzakh. Allah says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَمِنْ وَرَائِهِمْ بَرْزَخٌ إِلَى يَوْمٍ يُبْعَثُونَ. Then there are in the world of Barzakh. What comes after Barzakh? After Barzakh comes now al-Ba'th. Ba'th means what? Resurrection. مِنَ الْأَجْدَاثِ إِلَى رَبِّهِمْ يَنْسِلُونَ قَالُوا يَا وَيْلَنَا
One fariq
Then tell me, and the other one is?
Sa'id. This is basically a brief into the journey.
Long journey.
Long journey.
Tough journey.
Companionship doesn't help.
And your positions don't help.
And your money doesn't help.
Dirar,
he says, when he was describing Sayyidina Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Talib, karamallahu ta'ala wajha, he says, and I entered al-Masjid one time at night and saw him crying so that his face and his beard was overwhelmed in water of his tears. And he's holding his beard and he says, Ya dunya, rukmi ghayri, look at the journey that's scaring Ali ibn Abi Talib himself. Oh dunya, fool someone else other than me. And he says, oh, min qillati zad, not enough food on that journey. Wa wahshat al-tariq, and the roughness of the path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-maut, now after we have this preview on the journey, let's go through what death is. We don't believe that death is annihilation, يعني فناء للأرواح. No, we believe that death is actually a step in evolution of the human existence. Simply you move from one step to another step. It's a continuation of the path. It is not annihilation of the being.
No? You're there.
You're simply moving from alam dunya to alam al-barzakh, from alam al-barzakh to alam al-akhirah. That moving to Alam al-Barzakh has different laws. Alam al-Akhirah has different laws and different rules that are applicable. Every alam, every phase of the life of a human being has different rules and different regulations that apply to it.
Everything is different.
In this dunya, there is lies and there's truth. There's deceiving and there's honesty.
There is oppressor and there is oppressed. There is honor and there is cheating. There are kings and there are servants.
But the thing changes in Alam al-Barzakh. In the dunya, people guard people.
You see king as guards.
But in the Akhirah, everyone, the king and the servant, the power and the weak, the rich and the poor, they are all guarded by the malaika. And malaika surrounds everybody. In the dunya, a human being is a judge of the fellow human being. In the akhirah, Allah is the judge of all. In the dunya, a human being is valued based on his money and based on his position. And based on his power and pride, in the Akhirah, all that will fall down. And the only thing will be left is Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. مَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَهُ وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَهُ. That's the mizan. That's the scale. If you do an atom of good, you will see. If you do one atom of evil, you shall see. Therefore, we feel that what? Death is simply stripping you from the ability to choose anymore. You are there, you exist. But you have no choice anymore. You are on autopilot. What happens? You're there, but you can't choose. You now view. Nothing more, nothing less. What does that mean? When the believer dies, let's go through the trip real quick, the journey of death real quick. When the human being dies, the believer, Allah does not take the soul of the believer like this. Why? Does not take it rough like that. Why? Because this soul, the happiness of this soul while it was in the dunya, was to be close to Allah. The happiness of the tongue of the soul was to make dhikr of Allah. The happiness of the limbs of the soul, the hands and the feet when they were alive, is to make worship to Allah and to serve the creation of Allah. The soul was mixed in the love of Rasulullah. So therefore Allah does not take this soul abruptly like this. No. That soul of the believer will have a delegation of the malaika.
Delegation? Diplomatic delegation? Yes. Diplomatic delegation. Huh?
Wafd
min al-malaika al-kiram, radiallahu alayhi wa sallam,
they will come and nuruhum yas'a bayna aydihim. The nur is all over them. They're coming. And their smell is more beautiful than the mist. And when they come, the rahmah and the lutuf surrounds the entire place. They are the delegation of Allah to call the Habib of Allah. To call the slave who is beloved to Allah. To bring the slave who is close to Allah. To bring someone who Allah cares about and loves him so much. And therefore one of the malaika of the delegation says, Ya Abdullah, Ya Ayyatuha Nafsu Tayyiba. Oh pure and honorable soul, come out of this honorable body. من الجسد الطيب يا أيتها النفس الطيبة يا أيتها الروح الطيبة Oh honorable روح come out of this honorable body it's honorable to Allah honorable to the ملائكة honorable to the أنبياء honorable to the أولياء Allah honorable to the creation of Allah even the soil the body of the أولياء is honorable come out of this honorable body اخرجي الى رضوان الله ورحمته اخرجي الى رضوان الله وجنته come out to the pleasure of Allah and to the jannah of Allah and the narration say that al malaika take the soul of the believer they hand it with care and they have a different coffin now when someone died you put him in a coffin Al-Malaika have a different kafan, different coffin. They bring a coffin with them from Jannah. The smell and the odor of this coffin is from the odor of Jannah. They put the soul in and every single angel greets the soul. And they stop there, no, they take the soul. Now the man or the woman is still lying there, they haven't yet washed them. They take the soul up and elevate into heavens. All the way, and every time they meet a group of malaika on their way to heavens, they say, Assalamu alaikum, what is this good smell with you? They say, this is the soul of this honorable slave of Allah al-Kareem. And until they go in, until they knock on the first heaven, the doors, the gates of the first heaven, the malaika, the guards of the first door of heaven, they say, who is this? They say, we are the malaika of Allah, and we have with us a soul. Soul tayyiba, a soul of that is pleasurable, that is honorable to Allah. They open the doors and they greet the soul. And this one sky after the second to heavens, the third heavens, until it goes to the seventh heaven. The soul of the moment. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ya ayyatuha nafsul mutmainna. This is nafs mutmainna. It's comfortable, so it doesn't have to worry. This nafs, huh? Like always say, when we talk about nafsiyah, psychology, don't go to Freud and Erickson. It's okay, learn about them, and then go to the Quran, because all the nafsiyah is in the Quran. Ya ayyuhan nafsul mutmainna, wa nafsin wa ma sawwaha, inna nafsa la'ammara wa bisu. You have all these nafsiyah, the ulum of nafsiyah, and you go to everybody else. Ajib. How they have different measures of things. Yeah, 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 nafsul mutmainna. This is the Quran. Irji'i. Ya ayyatuha nafsul mutmainna. Irji'i ila Rabbi. Come back to your Lord. Radiyatan mardiyan. Fadkhuli fi ibadi wadkhuli jannati. Enter the Jannah. That soul now, this man is about to be washed. Huh? Comes back. After the seventh heaven, comes back and surrounds the body, its own body. Until that body now is being carried where? to the grave. And the soul goes to the body,
to the grave.
And it's around the body, sees and hears. It knows. It goes to the body, to the grave, until the people then put the body in the grave. Then the soul is reattached to the body, and the malaika now are asking. Hadith al-Bukhari by Anas, al-Bukhari Muslim, both narrated the hadith. They say, إِنَ الْعَبْدَ إِذَا وُضِعَ فِي قَبْرٍ نَبِيَ عَمَنْ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمْ. Now I said, النبي عَمَنْ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمْ people not make salah. النبي عَمَنْ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمْ. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله سيدنا محمد وعلى آله سلم. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله سيدنا محمد وعلى آله سلم. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله سيدنا محمد وعلى آله سلم. There's a secret for the salawat. I'll tell you why. When the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, when the man and when the slave is put in the grave, حتى إنه لا يسمع قبل نهاية كلام صرفه. The sense, now, خط لعالم وقرأ لعالم, the sense of hearing after you die will be increased. Now you have hearing. After you die, your hearing will be much increased, much higher. So the Nabi Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم says that when they put this man in the grave, he is able to hear the footsteps of his people who buried him when they are going away. Hearing their footsteps of sand when they're leaving. This is that, the hearing.
فَيُقْعِدَانَ The malakan, they come to him, they set him up,
and they say, مَا تَقُولُ فِي هَذَا الرَّجُلُ What do you say about this man? يعني محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم المؤمن.
حديث مسلم عند حديث البخاري ومسلم.
المؤمن says, أشهد أنه عبده ورسوله.
أشهد أنه عبد الله ورسوله. أشهد أنه عبد الله ورسوله.
الملائكة, the hadith says, الملائكة, they tell him this. They tell him, look, they show him the seat in hellfire. They say, this was your seat in hellfire. Allah has replaced it for you in the seat in Jannah. Look at the seat. فَيَرَهُمَا جَمْعَ جَمِيعًا He sees both seats. Then his grave is enlarged for him, and he basically made more comfortable, and is in pleasure until the day of judgment. Of course, what happens is a little bit more than that, because after that, that soul now goes to Jannah. You see its actual place in Jannah. The malaika take that soul to Jannah and it sees its place in Jannah, and that soul of the mu'min goes back and forth between Jannah and its grave and roams around. There are no limits, there are no borders, there are no distances, there are no time. It is in sukoon and tumanina, in happiness and pleasure, until the day of judgment, the time in the barzakh for the believer soul. Goes like a split second. Though it could be thousands of years in our the time on earth, but to them it's like the Salah of Dhuhr or the Salah of Asr. The thousands of years in our time. So that the soul of the believers even go around their relatives and they see and they hear about them. And of course, number one, as you all know, when the Ahmad and Tabarani narrate in their Musnad, that when the Mayyid, when the one who is deceased is put, he knows who washes him, he knows who gives him coffin, he knows who is washing him, and he knows who's putting him in the grave. All that is right. Not only that, the one who is deceased, we believe after death there is gathering of the souls. And the souls get together. And the 5, you see Baba Ibanas and Muhammad, he says, Muhammad, he says, I came to Jabir al-Abdullah al-Ansari, radiallahu ta'ala, this great Sahabi Jabir al-Abdullah, on his deathbed. And this is what did he tell what Muhammad said? He told him, Ya Jabir, when you go, give, tell Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that I sent my salam. When you go, so that means what? That means Sahih Bukhari. It means when that one dies, the soul doesn't die. The soul is with those that the soul loves. Therefore, you have to be careful who you love, because you will be gathered with those who love. Not only after the resurrection, no, before in the grave. Why? Because the Hadith Sahih and the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Al arwahu juludun jannah. Al-Arwah are like soldiers. Those Arwah, those souls that love each other will be together. And those souls that don't like each other will not be together. So therefore you see the Arwah of the Anbiya, Al-Awliya, Al-Muttaqeen, Al-Saliheen, you see them together. That's why the Sahabi, he told Jabir, he says, when you go to the Barzakh, when you go to the Barzakh, if when you meet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell them, I give him salam. And the hearing, they hear, you all know the hadith also that Bukhari narrated by us. When the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came from Badr, he stood and he talked in front of those people who were dead. Oh, Fulan and Fulan. He called them by their name, such, the son of such. Remember? أَوَجَدْتُمْ مَا مَعَدَكُمْ رَبُّكُمْ حَقَّى. Now do you see what Allah has promised you truly? Because I have seen what Allah promised me. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, he says, Ya Rasulullah, how can you speak to bodies that have no souls in? And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Ya Umar, you do not have better hearings, and you as all the humans that are alive, do not have better hearing day than they do. They hear me better than you do even. But they cannot reply. This is what the hadith say. But I don't want you to think that they don't reply in the sense that they don't reply. They reply, but humans don't hear them. They reply. The souls reply, but humans don't hear them. Why? There's a hadith in Bukhari, Sahih. And hadith says this. When the man is dead, and the janazah, and the man is put on the coffin, and people take him, the soul says, if it's a good soul, so ruh saliha mu'mina, it says, قَرِّبُمْ تَقَدَّمُوا تَقَدَّمُوا take me, advance me. And if it's not salihah, if it's not pious, it says, Ya Waylati, it screams. That soul of that person screams. It says, where are you taking me? Slow down, where are you taking me? They'll take to the grave, where are you taking me? And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Hadith al-Bukhari says, everything will hear the screaming of the soul except the human being. Hear them, interact with them. But a human being, then there's nothing here. Notice. So now what happened? There's washing, there's coffin, there's in the grave. Munkar wa Nakir, come ask the questions. You see, there's something about the grave, the darkness of the grave. The hadith by Abu Hurairah, the hadith says that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told them that these people have darkness in their graves. And my prayer on them, my salah on them, will put nur in their grave. What does that tell you? The ulama took from this something. If you are muhibb of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you are ashiq of Nabi Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then you're also, your grave will be nur. Not only because of you, because of the salawat that you gave on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But what determines Ashur Rasul Muhammad Rasul is what? How many times you make salat salam on him every single day? How many times you make fikr about him every single day? That will be the light on your grave. That will be the nur in your grave. Is that it? No. Earth and heavens cry
when the mu'min. When the mu'min departs, when the mu'min soul departs, heavens cry and earth cry. البيهقي ما البيهقي narrates in the Shu'ab by way of Sayyidina Amir al-Mu'mini Ali. He says, when the mu'min soul dies, his musalla, the place where he used to make salah on earth, the sand where he would stand and make salah, cries on his departure. Heavens cry, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, فَمَا بَكَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ السَّمَاءُ وَالْأَرْضُ. Allah says in the Quran, when the people of Fir'aun, when the kuffar died, heavens and earth did not cry on them. What does that mean? It means heavens and earth cry on the believers. That's why don't be amazed when you hear that when Imam Hassan or Imam Hussein departed, heavens and earth were crying on them. Rocks were crying. Allah says, "What about the heavens and earth? Heavens and earth not cry on the non-believers, but heavens and earth cry on those. They interact, they miss you, and they go and testify their judgment for you." We are going to believe further more than that. We believe that the life in the barzakh, not in the grave, remember. In the barzakh, because the barzakh could be grave, could be not grave. There are some people who, for example, die drowning. Some people who die burned on the other side. They're in the barzakh. Barzakh is there for that type. If that in the barzakh we believe that there is life, actually people in the barzakh are visiting each other. Yes, they are visiting each other. Are they doing some obedience and some ta'at? Yes. Are they reciting and reading the Quran? Yes. Are they praying in their grave, in their barzakh? Yes. There's a whole life. There's a whole life there. In Bayhaqi narrates, Al-Anbiya al-Ahyaan fi quburihim yusallun. Al-Anbiya are alive, they are praying in their graves. You say this is in Bayhaqi and maybe has some weakness there. Let me take it to Sahih Muslim. So that's what Sahih Imam Muslim. Authentic of Hadith Imam Muslim by us, he says, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, when I was going in the day of the night of Isra, Hadith Sahih Imam Muslim, I stopped by Musa and he was praying in his grave. When Nabi Aham sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was going in the night of Isra, he stopped by Musa, and Musa, what was Musa doing? Praying in his grave, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ala nabiyyina wa ala, kufru salati wa sallam. They are praying there. They're there. Huh? Al-Anbiya wa-Ahya. They are alive. Alive in the world of Barzakh. That has much more implications than the life of the dunya. Much more, many more characteristics and attributes in the world of the dunya. Is that it only? No. Let me get to this hadith. Hakim narrates this hadith and others by Ibn Abbas. Ibn Abbas said, a group of Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu went and they put their tent, went out and they put their tent somewhere in the desert at the night to sleep the night. They didn't realize that this place is where a grave of some Muslim was buried there. He said, these Sahaba that put their tent there were scared because the minute they put their tent, they heard the sound from this under them reciting Surah Al-Mulk, Tabarak al-Ladhi biyadihi al-Mulk. The hadith, the narration says, the man or the one who's buried recited Surah Al-Mulk all the way till the end of the surah. They took the tent away and they ran back to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They said, Ya Rasulullah, this is what happened and this is what we heard. The man in the grave is reciting Surah Al-Mulk. And Nabi A'lam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Hiya al-mani'a, hiya al-munjiya. Tunji min adab al-qabr. This is the surah that is a protector from the punishment in the grave, from the torment in the grave. That's why these people were reciting it. And therefore you see many of the souls of the mu'mins reciting independent qabr. Or in the barzakh, al-Qur'an al-Azim. So much that Habib ibn Rajab, he mentions, he said, one wali, one alim took me to Samarra, Iraq some Iraq and took me to a grave of a pious man. And since this man was buried until now years, every time people come close to him, they hear Surah Al-Mulk being recited.
You know, some of our people, they say, what do you mean reciting Quran?
First of all, yani the hadith will say, once you die, that's it, there's no more accountability, there's no more thawab, there's no more ikhlas, that's it, and basically, what you have done up until today is what you're going to be judged on. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. One, laysa lil-insani illa ma sa'a. Al-insan will only have to be accountable until the day he died.
No, how come they recite the Quran? What's the benefit?
Will they benefit after they die? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sahih Muslim says, إِذَا مَاتَ ابْنُ آدَمْ انْقَطَعَ عَمَلُهُ إِلَّا مِنْ ثَلَاثٍ.
When the son of Adam dies, his deeds will stop. How come you're saying that they go in their graves and they are reciting Quran?
Ibn Raja said this, look at this. He said, some of the people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives some people, some of his creation, the endowment and the blessings to do some ta'at, some worships, even in the grave. Why is that? Because not so they can reap the rewards, no, their deeds stop when they die. But because to them, much more important than their deeds was the dhikr of Allah. They were so attached to the dhikr of Allah that this is the biggest thing that you can give them. Therefore, they remain in dhikr of Allah, not wanting a reward or something, a payback for that dhikr. Not wanting something in return for that dhikr. But they are in the dhikr for the dhikr. Therefore, they will always be with dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't treat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like you treat each other. Here, Al-Kareem. Al-Kareem. Imam Hassan, radiallahu anhu alayhi salam, when he would enter the masjid, he would say, before he entered, he says, إِلَهِ ضَيْفُكَ بِبَابِكَ. Oh, Allah, your guest is at your door. Your guest is at your gate. Ya Muhsin! And he would say, how? Ya Muhsin, in the name of Allah. Oh, Muhsin, قَدْ أَتَاكَ الْمُسِيدِ. The sinner is coming into your house. Treat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as generous, because he is a generous. When you make dhikr, when you come to the masjid, come because you love Allah. Come because you want to do the dhikr. Taste the sweetness of the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you can become among the dhakireen. Because to the people of dhikr, the biggest ni'mah Allah gives them is the dhikr. The biggest ni'mah. The biggest ni'mah. You leave them in dhikr and they are drowning in dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are instead of jazm, instead of haal with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing matters to them when they are in dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So much that we know that the Prophet Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that snakes were biting him when he was in the haal, he did not feel anything. The dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Where are you going? You see, you taste the sweetness. ذَاقَ حَلَاوَةَ الْإِيمَانِ. And the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, ذَاقَ means taste. Taste. Why taste? Why will feel? Why will get? Why not see? Let me take you to another thing also. And when it comes to death, the Quran says, كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. Every self will taste death. Taste. Why doesn't the Quran say every nafs will see death? Why doesn't the Quran say every nafs will hear death? Why the Quran doesn't say every nafs will be faced with death? Why says taste? What's the point? Is there wisdom? Of course there is wisdom. Because tasting is different than seeing. When you see something, you may get one aspect of it. But when you taste something, it goes into yourself and it goes into every single cell in you and it embodies you everywhere and you all become a feeling of this thing. So when kullu nafsin dha'iqatu al-maut, every cell will taste death, it means that death will not only be seen or heard, it will go into every single cell you have when you think of it. You will taste it.
But the same thing goes for the iman.
You will taste iman.
Is that it? Let me give you another hadith also by Hakim, an authenticated.
He said, the Nabi Adam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, look at this hadith, beautiful hadith. And Nabi Adam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, telling his Sahaba of the Quran, said, last night I went to Jannah.
His Rawla is Jannah. His place where he's buried is Jannah.
Where he put his feet, that's the Jannah of the dunya. That's the Jannah that takes his Jannah of the Akhirah.
What do you think? Why do you think you say it's called Rawla? Rawla min Riyadi al-Jannah.
Subhanallah.
What?
Huh?
That's what it is? Because when you visit that Rawla,
Allahu Akbar.
Now, he says, I went to Jannah last night and I saw, this hadith is authenticated by Hakim, says, I saw Ja'far ibn Abi Talib. I'm telling you so you can see what happens. The reason I'm saying is the hadith, brothers and sisters, so you can see that in the alam of barzakh,
the souls communicate, the souls are doing things, there is interaction, there's a whole world, they're going back and forth, they know who's coming, they exchange news, they exchange things.
It's a whole world, and just because you don't see it, just because you don't see it doesn't mean it doesn't exist.
There is a, it's okay to get off topic for a minute. There was one communist teacher, one of the, maybe I've told you this before, but there's one communist teacher in one of the schools in Syria, 30, 40 years ago, 30 years ago or so. This communist teacher teaching young kids. Unfortunately, this man was not honorable to his principle of even being communist. He's trying to make everyone, all these little children, communist. As well, don't believe in that. There's no creator, there's no Allah. So when he tells them, he's 7, 8 years old, he tells them, do you see the teacher? The student said, yeah, we see the teacher. He said, then the teacher exists. Do you see the blackboard? They said, yes, we see the blackboard teacher. He said, then the blackboard exists. Do you see the piece of chalk? They said, yes, we see the piece of chalk. He said, then the piece of chalk exists. Do you see the pen? We see the pen. Then the pen exists. Then he stopped and said, do you see Allah? And the student says, no, we don't. He told them, then Allah doesn't exist. One of the students stood up and told the students, do you see the brain of the teacher? They said, no. He said, then his brain doesn't exist. Seeing is believing. It depends what you see with. If you see with your heart, yes. But if you see only with your eyes, then you're only fooling yourself. Because as Sahabi al-Kabir ibn Umm Maktum, who was blind, he was seeing the basira. Therefore, the Quran does not talk about the basar. He says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ عَلَى بَصَرٍ لَا عَلَى بَصِيرٍ On the basira. أَنَا وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَ And mu'min, when they lose their sight, they have the basira of La ilaha illallah. Makes them guidance through, even in the darkest of times, in the day of judgment. In the mahshar, when there is no sun, and there is no moon, and there is no stars, and everything is dark, the mu'min comes by himself, نُورُهُمْ يَسْعَى بَيْنَ إِلِيهِمْ Their nur is lighting their way through. Some people will have different kind of nur. They will be guided by the nur al-Muhammadi sallallahu alayhi. And some people will be guided by the Muhammadi nur even in the barzakh. لِمِثْلِ ذَلِكَ فَلْيَعْمَلِ الْعَامِلُونَ وَفِي مِثْلِ ذَلِكَ فَلْيَتَنَافَسِ الْمُتَنَافِسُونَ This is where the competition is. I'm telling you again these things so you can see. Let me take you to Surah Yasin. Mu'min
and Yasin. Habib al-Najjar, his name. You all know the event. I'm not teaching anything new. I'm sharing it. مُضْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلًا أَصْحَابَ الْقَرْيَةِ Look at the insan, how rude human beings can be. How ظالم لنفسه. ظالم لنفسه.
والعياذ بالله.
You give him some money. إن الإنسان ليطغى أراه استغنى. الله says he'll make becomes tyrant when he gives him some power.
That's the meaning.
ودخل جنته وهو ظالم
نفسه.
Allah gave him this mushnah. Allah gave him this result. How can you become ظالم? You become time to see now this is it. You think you're going to be last thing in this dunya? Allah says, وَدَخَلَ
جَنَّتَهُ وَهُوَ ظَالِمٌ لِنَفْسِهِ قَالَ مَا أَظُنُّ أَن تَبِيدَ هَذِهِ أَبَدًا.
Ya Allah, we can see. This man, when he went and entered, he saw his kingdom, he has so many things, he said, this will never perish. Is that what he's talking about?
وَمَا أَظُنُّ السَّاعَةَ قَائِمَةً.
There's no meaning to that. There's no meaning to that. Allah. Habib Najjar in Surah Yasin. Allah sends this man, this qadr, this little village messenger. إِذْ أَرْسَلْنَا إِلَيْهِمُ.
We sent the two messengers.
What happened?
They belied them. They tortured them. They called them names. They called them labels. فَكَذَّبُوهُمَا
فَعَزَّزْنَا بِثَلَثٍ.
We sent the third messenger, Allah mentions. I mean, huh? Three messengers from one village? Yes. Anyway, they gave him, so we don't have to know what we have there.
اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله. وجاء رجلا من أقصى المدينة يسعى.
The people in the village, they belied these messengers, they tortured them. A man was running from the end of the village. Allah says, وجاء رجلا من أقصى المدينة يسعى. Came running to all the people of the village. قال يا قوم اتبعوا المرسلين.
Oh people, follow the messengers. Why are you belying them?
اتبعوا من لا يسألكم أجرا.
Follow those who are not asking you anything in return for that.
وهم مهتدون. They are guided. They're not telling you, make me the boss, make me the chief, make me this. No. They told him, they looked at him. They said, we thought you were part of us. We thought that you were one of us. Are you like him? Do you worship their God?
What does Allah say on his behalf?
وَمَا لِيَ لَا أَعْبُدُ الَّذِي فَطَرَنِي وَإِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ.
Why should I worship the one who created me? And you will all be assembled back to him.
They said, now you have one more chance. If you don't repent and go back to worshiping our idols, we will kill you. He looked at them and he smiled. He says,
أَتَّخِذُ مِن دُونِهِ آلِهَةً.
There's no way I can take another God other than Allah.
أَتَّخِذُ مِن دُونِهِ آلِهَةً إِن يُرِدْنِي الرَّحْمَنُ بِضُرٍّ لَا تُغْنِي عَنِّي شَفَاعَتُهُمْ شَيْئًا وَلَا يُنقِذُونَ.
If Allah wants to harm me, then all these gods will do anything for me. And they can never save me. They said, this is your last chance. They put this knife on his neck. قال, they said, say it, the last thing. He said, إِنِّي آمَنْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ فَاسْمَعُونَ. He declared it, I am a believer in Allah, so hear me everybody, even if the knife is right here. They slit his throat. They cut his neck.
When they cut his neck, the malaika came rushing. And malaika rushing, Jibreel, this malaika Maud, the malaika rushing down to earth to this beautiful, honorable soul, showing the soul the place in Jannah. Showing the soul what Allah prepared for it. And the man was still, when someone dies, still has a couple of seconds of life. What did this man say? He says,
قَالَ يَا لَيْتَ قَوْمِي يَعْلَمُونَ.
I wish that my people are seeing بِمَا wish they were seeing what I am seeing. يا ليت قومي يعلمون بما غفر لي ربي. By what Allah has forgiven me, وجعلني من المكرمين. Going back to the hadith, sometime we'll talk about Muhammad Ali Yasin, a big story about Allah. The hadith says, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I was in Jannah and I saw Ja'far ibn Abi Talib flying with the angels of Jannah, with the malaika. Is Ja'far in Jannah right now as we speak. Right now, Ja'far radiallahu ta'ala anhu is in Jannah flying with the malaika. He has now friends, he makes friends with the malaika everywhere they go. And he said, I saw Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib sitting on like a sofa. Sitting, doing things. I'm telling you these things because they're doing things. Their actions, they are activating their etc. We go now to the point of reciting Quran. Of course, first of all, the soul of the evil doers, of the people of evil, the tyrants, etc. That's not how it's received. The angels come with the worst picture and the worst voices. And they look, they come in a scary way. And they look at the soul and the person on his deathbed becomes shaky. And they say, one of them say, أخرجي أيتها الروح الخبيثة. Oh, this خبيث روح, come out of this جسد خبيث, this body that's خبيث. أخرجي إلى عذاب الله وغضبه. Go up, come out to the anger of Allah, the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on you. And they take the soul and they wrap it up with a bag that is filled like with thorns. And they try to take it up, but the doors are not open. And it was ordered to go down. Then the soul goes around its grave, around its people who are taking the body to the grave, and it's screaming to stop going, don't go anywhere, stop right here, don't take me anywhere, until the malaika, of course, answer. When they go to the grave, then the malaika will come and they will ask the questions. And these people will shake, they will not want to answer, because they did not pray in their lives, and they did not do good deeds in their lives, and they were backbiting this, and gossiping this, and eating haram, and talking haram, and looking haram, and touching haram, and feeling haram, and seeing haram, and hearing haram, and their whole life is haram, haram. What do you think they're going to be answering? And therefore their answer is not going to be there. And therefore they will be shown their seat in Jahannam, waliyadu billah. They will be shown their seat in Jahannam so that their soul and their body will be shaking from this picture that they see, and they will wish that the day of judgment never comes and be delayed and delayed and delayed, and every day they live in the barzakh is by thousands and thousands of years. It takes us, dear brothers and sisters, to the end, the conclusion of this, because there's something that we have to do. Hadith Sahih is authenticated by Uthman radiallahu anhu. When he used to see the grave, he would cry. They told him, Ya Uthman, why are you crying when you see the grave and you don't cry when you hear about Jannah and Nar? He says, because I heard Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying that the grave is the beginning. If it's good, then everything after that is good. But if it's bad, then everything after that is bad. The point of the grave is this. Sulaiman ibn al-Malik, from Hisham ibn al-Malik, one of the Umar rulers, he told one of his people, well, it seems like he's a knowledgeable scholar, his name is Abu Hazim. He said, Ya Abu Hazim, why do we hate death?
Hisham is the Khalifa.
Why do we hate death? The scholar told him, can I tell you honestly? Nek was said. He said, because you construct, you build your dunya and destroy your akhirah. Therefore, you're scared to go from the building, construction, to the destruction. Don't build your dunya and destroy your akhirah. Don't build the dunya and destroy the akhirah. Malik ibn Dinar, rahimahullah, his name is wife coming up, he says, أتيت القبور فناديتها. He came to the graveyard and he said these two lines of poetry. I came to the graveyard and I asked the graveyard, فأين المعظم والمحتقر؟ Where is the one who was honorable and who is the one who was weak? وأين المذل بسلطانه؟ Who's the one who was sultan? وأين الفقير؟ وأين العزيز المفتخر؟ Where is the عزيز? Where is the one who was showing off? Where is the one with the money? Where is the one with the power? Where are they? It seems like I don't see them. He said, I heard a voice coming back telling me, ماتوا جتفانوا جميعا. They all died. ومات الخبر. And the news have also died. فيا سائلي عن أناس مضوا أما لك فيما مضى معتبر. You are asking me about things, people who passed away. Don't you take lesson from those who passed away? Therefore, the زيارة القبور is a sunnah. النبي الأعظم صلى الله عليه وسلم visited the قبور and he asked us to visit the قبور because you know, when you visit the Qubur, it's not only about the Qubur. You think, the poet says, when you go and when you walk on earth now, even here on the sand, walk with ease on the sand. Why? He says, because the sand and the soil of this earth is mixed with the bodies of dead people. Billions of people died before you. Take it easy when you're walking. Don't walk with arrogance because you're a human being. You are also going to be mixture in that soil that people also will step on you one day. Take it easy. When you go to that soil, that grave, visit the grave and take his inspiration. The poet says, كرر على سمعي حديث أحبتي. Repeat the mentioning of my ahibba, my beloved, on my ears. فبذكرهم تتنزل الرحمات. Because whenever you mention them, the rahamat will be revealed. واحضر مجالسهم تنال الرضا. Come to the majalis of the awliya of Allah. You will have the pleasure of Allah. وقبورهم زرها إذا هم ماتوا. When they die, go visit their graves. Because that's where the blessings of Allah will be. That's where the greatness and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي. Everlasting greatness and blessings are coming on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and those who are around him. That's why we visit the graves. That's why visiting the grave is extremely important. The life after in the barzakh, dear brothers, is unexplainable because we have so many things and so many things happen. And it's a world of where physics, distance, and time doesn't matter. I asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among the first kinds of souls, the mu'mineen. ويا أيها النفس المطمئنة ارجعي إلى ربك راضية رضية فادخلي في عبادي وادخلي جنتي. And in order for us to do that, we have to have the love of Allah and the love of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم and the love of أولياء الله عليه السلام رضي الله عنهم. Why? Because that's where your soul will be hanging with their soul, and because of their soul you might be forgiven. Because of your love to them, you might be forgiven. And so your soul can be associated with their soul in the barzakh and in the akhirah. Because the mu'min will be assembled with those who love. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make our journey in the barzakh a journey of ease and a journey of happiness. So we become like, even not like, but close to Bilal radiallahu anhu wa arda. When he was on his deathbed and his wife and his daughter was crying, he said, don't cry anymore. Now I will be meeting Muhammad wa sallam. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who are happy to meet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because these people will go and they will be facing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They will meet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they will be under his care. And they will be around him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts his blessings on us to make us among them, at least, or like them, or attaches us with them. إِنَّهُ سَمِيعٌ مُجِيبٌ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى سَيِّدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمَ. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.